Hello everyone. So in the previous class we have discussed about the different types of water treatment units. So in this class we shall discuss about the sources of water, the water quality, the water resources on the surface of the earth. Okay, so what is meant by potable water, so things like that. So that is the sources of water characteristics, its quality and quantity. Okay. So what is water actually? Okay, so water is a vital natural resource which forms basis of life. Okay, so for every process of our life we need water. So without water, so there is no life. In fact, so you might be aware that the very first organism to exist on earth was a blue green algae, which has taken its form of life because of the water. So chemically water is written as H2O, that is it contains of two atoms of hydrogen and one atom of oxygen. It is called as, water is called as an universal solvent because it will dissolve any solvent which when it comes in contact with that kind of, when it comes in contact with water. So it is usually found in three states, that is solid, liquid and gases. And 97% of the earth's surface is covered by water, and also animals and plants have 60 to 65% of water in their body, and we as humans, we also have more than 95% of water in our human cell. Okay, so water is a very vital natural resource which is required for proper growth and development of humans, and as well as it is required for other living beings. So coming to the hydrological cycle, so you might have known this in your previous classes, that so the hydrological cycle is a perfectly balanced cycle, and it is an endless hydrological cycle. So that means water keeps on recirculating and it changes its phases, and it is a cyclic process. The phases of this hydrological cycle involves the evaporation or transpiration, precipitation, condensation and runoff. Okay, so maybe you will understand more in by using this picture. So here what happens, using sun as a source of energy, the because of the heat energy of the sun, the water from the surface of the earth, it gets evaporated and it is formed into the clouds. Okay, so also there is a process called as transpiration, which means that the water present from the plants will also be evaporated because of the sun's energy. So because of the evaporation and transpiration, the water gets evaporated and it will be condensed in the clouds. Okay, it is a natural process, and the condensation, the precipitation happens by the clouds. So when because of the intermolecular forces and other climatic factors, the precipitation happens. That means we receive the water in the form of rainfall, that is called as precipitation, and that rain again when it falls back onto the surface of the earth, so it may be formed into natural lakes and rivers, and some water also percolates into the soil. Okay, so that is called as groundwater, and because of the surface elevation, so water will be stored, so that in the form of lakes, and water will also flows in the rivers, so that is called as the flowing water or the water flowing in the river. So and this process is actually a cyclic one, and this keeps on happening in the nature. So this is called as a hydrological cycle. So this is how water keeps on recycling. So the major aspect what we have to select is the selection of the site for the source of the water. So here the four points are listed here. So one is location. That means if we are supplying water to a particular community, it's the location of the source of water is important. That means because, so as we have seen in the previous presentation and previous class, that the water when we want to supply, it has to go to lot of physical and chemical changes. That means we have to treat the water as per the standards, and we have to maybe pump the water by long distances using pumps and other sewer pipelines and underground excavation works and all. So that's why as far as possible we should see that the location should be nearer as a source of to the source of water and to the community. So we should select the carefully select the location. Then the elevation of intake point. So as far as possible, we should see that the water is supplied under the influence of gravity. Only in certain extreme cases, so where there is no proper surface elevation, or there is no possibility of supplying water under the influence of gravity, only in that case we have to go for pumping. Because pumping involves again the cost, and it adds to the cost of the project. So to save that cost, we should see that. So as far as possible, so we should properly survey the area and find that the water, and found that water should be supplied using the gravity as far as possible. Then we should see how much quantity of water is available. So this is an important function of the population. We have seen that we will have to first identify, we have to calculate or estimate the total population, and we will predict the future population of 3 to 4 decades, and for that population we have to decide the how much quantity of water is required. So whatever the source we are selecting, so we should see that whether this source is able to supply the water and satisfy the needs of their industrial, domestic and other water needs. So then only we have to use that as a source of water. So otherwise, if we are selecting a wrong source of water, then we may not be supplying required water to the community, and we will be spending lots of cost for the project like excavation, pumping, etc. Then quality of water is also important. So the quality is water quality is prescribed by the regulatory authorities. Like in India, it is done by Indian Council of Medical Research or Bureau of Indian Standards. So conforming to the standards laid down by the Bureau of Indian Standards, we have to supply water to the community, and that water should be of very good quality. So coming to sources of water, so broadly the sources of water is classified into two different types: surface water and groundwater. So the water which is formed on the surface of the water, that is called as the surface water. So you might have seen the rivers, ponds and natural streams, and also the storage reservoirs. Lakes are again artificial and man-made. So artificial lakes are the one which is being constructed to store the water, so for supplying the water to the communities. Maybe we can extract the water through the rivers or reservoirs, and we'll store that, and the artificial lakes will be formed. So similarly, we might also have the dams as the storage structures, so and water can be stored, and that water can be used for the consumers to supply water by a proper water supply scheme. So we also have groundwater sources, that means the water in the form of natural springs. Then we have infiltration galleries. So these are the structures which are constructed around the water bodies like rivers and lakes, so that water gets percolated, and it will be we can get enough water whenever we want to extract the water using the infiltration galleries. And also we have natural we have to dug the wells. Sometimes people dug the wells, underground wells, to extract the water. So that is called as the wells or underground water. So springs are the natural ones. In some places the water will ooze out from the ground, so in the form of hot springs and also cold springs. It is there in many locations around the globe, so wherein water comes out naturally from the ground. So those things are called as the springs. Okay, and people actually take bath in the springs, considering it as a sacred water. So that is being there. It is at many places you can find these natural springs. So water is distributed on the surface of the earth, as we have seen. So 97% of the water on the earth is salt water. That means the water is stored in the oceans, and that water is very difficult to use for drinking purpose, because we have to spend a huge amount of money for to make the water fit for drinking, because it contains lot of salts. We have to spend much of energy to get the pure drinking water from the sea water. So only 3% of water is available as fresh water. So in that, again, over 2/3 of this portion is frozen in the form of glaciers and polar ice caps. The remaining unfrozen fresh water is found as groundwater, with only a smaller fraction present above the ground or in the air. Okay, and fresh water is a renewable source, so the water keeps on circulating, as we have seen in the water cycle. So here the groundwater by the source, as you can see, the surface water covers the 97% and only we have 3% as the groundwater. That means we have a very huge surface water source compared to the groundwater source. So this is the distribution of water on the earth. So this will give you the picture of the total quantity of water availability on the surface of the earth. So the earth's water, you can see that it is most 97% is in saline condition. That is, it is very salty in nature and it is very difficult to use this as a source of water unless we spend much of money and effort to make the water fit for drinking. In that, we have 3% of the fresh water. So again, this fresh water is divided into groundwater, and some part of that, almost 68%, is frozen in the form of ice caps and glaciers. And in that, groundwater constitutes about 30.1%, and the other sources in the form of surface water like rivers, lakes and all estuaries consist of 0.9%. So in that surface water, so 87% of the water is stored in the form of natural lakes, and swamps consist of 11%, and rivers will be having a share of around only 2%. And this is the fresh to liquid surface water, so which is available to us, and this is the only source through which we have to manage the water, and we have to supply the water to the all the people of globe for all their applications, that is for all their uses. It may be domestic use, industrial use, or firefighting, water for irrigation. Everything we have to satisfy only with a very little water which is available. And it really, it is a very challenging task for sanitary engineers to manage the water effectively and satisfy the needs of the consumers. So groundwater utilization by the sector, as you can see here, so the 60% of groundwater is used by the domestic sector, and only 5% is used for agriculture sector, and industrial use is of 33%. And where do people get their water from? So water, people use their water in by different sources, which is listed here. So 2% of water we can get it from the field, and 10% of the water using river, tank and stream, and 25% water is used is taken from public taps, and only 17% of water is a piped water supply. Okay, so piped water supply is the one, so wherein we and most of the people do not have access to the piped water supply. And 10% of water is taken from rivers, tanks and streams, and 12% from open wells, 18% from borewell or hand pump, and 16% from mini water supply tanks. Okay, so people, we use water from all these sources, and we use water for our uses. So surface water is the water in a river, lake or fresh water wetland. So surface water is naturally replenished by precipitation. Okay, we might have seen that in the flowing rivers, and most of the rivers are not perennial. That means they do not flow throughout the year. So whenever the water is flowing in the river, we can use it as a source of water, or we can extract that water and store in a lake, or we can construct a dam across the river and store the water and in the form of a storage reservoir, and ultimately all that water again joins to the ocean and the operation takes place in the that is what the hydrological cycle which we have discussed. And what are the characteristics of this surface water? So surface water, as we have seen, the precipitation occurs from the cloud and it will travel a very long path, and the rivers and lakes will be formed. So based on where the water actually falls on the surface of the earth, because as we have known, the water is a universal solvent, it picks up all the impurities, minerals, soil, silt, clay, everything, and the river water is formed. So that's why the physical and chemical characteristics vary a lot in case of the surface water. And also it contains many sand and clay silt particles. It may also contain lot of bacteria, algae, than other forms of microbes which comes along with the flow of the water. So hence, before supplying this water, it has to be treated properly by using appropriate treatment technologies which we have discussed to remove all forms of these impurities and supply water to the community. Then we have the frozen water. So the water which is usually found in the frozen state in the Himalayas and in the polar regions, so this water, although it is very difficult to use this water because it is in frozen conditions and temperature will be very less here, and it is difficult to use this water as a source of water. But even then, because of its purity, this water is having lot of importance, and comparatively the cost of each liter of this water is literally very high compared to the normal water what we get as a source of water. Okay, so because of its the mineral content and its purity, so this, since this water is protected and it is not having that much impurities compared to the other surface and groundwater sources, so the water is having very good quality, and that's why it is relatively costlier compared to the other mineral water which is available. And coming to groundwater, so groundwater is formed again due to the precipitation. So due to the precipitation, based on the ground conditions, the water will be percolated and it will be stored below the soil. So that we call it as groundwater. So in that again, so the groundwater is divided into two types. Okay, so aquifer is nothing but a water body which is formed below the surface of the earth is called as aquifer. So there are basically two types of aquifer. So one is called as confined aquifer and unconfined aquifer. Okay, and this is the water table. So water table is the minimum depth available below the surface of the earth where you can extract the water. So when you dig the soil below the surface of the earth, you may get the water, and this water is nothing but the water which is being percolated or which is being joined to the underground streams, and so that level is called as the water table. And it is called as an unconfined aquifer whenever the water is available between unconfined layer and confined layer. So this is a percolation permeable layer, and this is an impermeable layer. That means this is the confinement. It is consists of a hard rock which will not allow the water to percolate through this layer. Okay, and this aquifer, which where the water is stored between one confined layer and one unconfined layer, is called as unconfined aquifer. Okay, so similarly, if the water is stored between two hard rocks or two hard impermeable layers, so that is called as confined aquifer. Okay, and relatively the water source, the water from the confined source is be having relatively more quantity of water compared to the unconfined layer. Okay, and the confined aquifer is a more reliable water source than the unconfined aquifer. Okay. Then what is the characteristics of groundwater? So groundwater characteristics is relatively different than the surface water, because so as the water percolates through the surface of different surface of the layers in the below the soil, below the earth, so as it percolates, it picks up the minerals wherever it is percolating. Because as you have seen, the earth may contain the different layers, that is earth crust may contain the lithosphere layer consists of different types of minerals and other layers. So based on that, the water will be rich in the mineral content, and it may also have very high iron content, because the soil contains more quantity of iron, and it is the relatively harder than the surface water. The hardness will be relatively more in case of groundwater compared to the surface water, because as it percolates, it picks up lot of minerals containing the salts of calcium and magnesium. That's why the hardness will be relatively more compared to the surface water. And since it will not be having much of impurities, a little disinfection is required. So unless the water is contaminated by leachate or any other groundwater pollution sources, so the groundwater is pure and it is clearer compared to the surface water. So that's why we have to, before selecting a source, we have to do an analysis, that is water quality analysis and as well as quality analysis, and we have to decide the type of treatment which is required. And this is the cycle. So nowadays, as we have seen, due to the rapid industrialization and huge quantity of industries and a huge surge in the population and other techno-commercials, of various industries are coming up, and because of all these things, so these industries and these chemicals, lot of chemicals and the fertilizers, whatever we use for our irrigating our agricultural fields, so all these things ultimately they join the water bodies. Okay, so these water bodies are getting heavily polluted, and ultimately these water bodies are again putting the loads of pollutants into the oceans, and these are actually the huge sinks of the pollutants. So it is very challenging for sanitary engineers to remove the different forms of impurities present in the water and supply the safe water to the communities. Okay, so already we are having very less water resources, in that the water sources which are available are heavily polluted. So we have to carefully do this analysis, and we have to appropriately design the effective treatment method, and we have to supply the water to the community. And it is really a great challenge faced by almost all sanitary engineers throughout the globe. Water requirement. So water requirement is nothing but finding out what is the total water requirement. So it is given by per capita demand into population. So population is a very important function of this water requirement. We have seen that, so we have various types of demand like domestic, industrial, fire demand, etc., and we have to carefully estimate that. So based on the standard of living of the people, and for most of the Indian conditions, the per capita demand is around 150 LPCD, and the quantity has to be to estimate the quantity, the per capita demand should be multiplied with the population, and we will usually design the water supply scheme for 30 to 40 decades of future population. So where do we use water? Okay, so we use water for most of our domestic purposes. Here, indoor household water, for a toilet we use around 26.8%, for others we use 2.3%, and there could be some leakages which is around 13.7%, which should be carefully checked to save the these leakages. And we use dishwasher, we use around 1.4%, and for bathing we use around 1.7%, for faucets we use 15%, for taking shower we may use 16.7%, and for washing clothes it is 21.7%. from all these things, so these two forms the major share. So that's why, so in order to save the water, somehow we have to manage the water which is used in these two sectors, and we have to fix the leakages, so then we can relatively have a very create a big impact in saving the water. Nowadays there are modern flushes which require very less water, that is around 4 to 6 liters of water. Earlier there was 10 to 12 liters of water was used in one flush. We may have to use more than 20-25 liters of water before and after flush after using these toilets, but nowadays some technological advancements have been made, and it is being the bucket, the flush, each flush will be having around only 3 to 6 liters nowadays, and it is still being modernized to save the water for what which is used for flushing. Nowadays we have the closed washers, so which some innovations are also happening in this industry to consume the less water, that is the different kinds of tub arrangements and the soap saver arrangements have been put into place, so that the same water can be used twice for the per bath for cleaning one batch of water. So likewise some innovations have been also made in showers, so along with the water some air pressure is also released, so that the person who is taking a shower feels that he is using more water, but actually he'll be using less water. So there are some modern fittings nowadays which is being done, innovated by different companies just to save the water which we consume. So water use in India, so we use the major share is of agriculture. As Indians we depend more on agriculture, as an agriculture is an important occupation of our people, so we use more water for agriculture, and we have to somehow practice modern agriculture innovation practices like drip irrigation, sprinkler irrigation and all, instead of water using for flooding, and we can save huge quantity of water if you manage the water effectively in case of agriculture sector. And in domestic we use 5%, and industrial we use 15%. So water consumption industry, so the major share is taken by the thermal power plants, because so the majorly we depend on power by using thermal power plant. We have very less the coal based power plants and solar energy, but nowadays we are also focusing more on renewable energy sources rather than thermal and coal based power plants. But still, since we have more the thermal power plants wherein we use water for the generation of steam, and that is steam is used to rotate the turbine and converting this mechanical energy into electrical energy, so we use more water in those sector. So in paper and pulp industries we use water, in steel industries, in fertilizer industries, in engineering industries, in textiles, in sugars and others, but the major share is taken by these thermal power plants. So what are basic terms in water? So potable water, so the treated or disinfected drinking water is called as potable water. That means P-O-T-A-B-L-E. So potable water is the one which is free from all form of impurities, or the water which is treated and disinfected and which is used for drinking. That water we call it as potable water. That means whatever the water we drink in each one of us drink using the filters. So that water is called as the potable water in our individual houses. So palatable water means at a desirable temperature. That is water free from objectionable tastes, odor, color and turbidity. So that water is called as palatable. That means the water which is good in taste, and the water should have desirable temperature of up to 15 degrees centigrade, so that a person who drinks this water should not have any bad taste and should not feel any bad odor, and the color should be sparkling and transparent, and it should be free from turbidity. So that water we call it as palatable water. And the water which may be containing some undesirable matter, so that is the disease causing organisms, is called as a polluted water or contaminated water. The water which may be containing some pathogenic bacteria is called as contaminated water, and any undesirable substances which may be present in the water, that is called as polluted water. That means the bad odor, that means some color can be added by some textile industry, or some sewage may be discharged which may be lead to the black color of water or a gray color of water, or some pollutants in the form of pesticides, the chemical pollutants, the biological pollutants, or any undesirable substances when we add to the water, then we call that water as polluted water. So these are some of the basic terms which are used in the water. So then impurities in water. So as we know that water is a universal solvent, it picks up all the minerals, it contains silt, dissolved impurities, chemical impurities, physical impurities, all these forms, and it may also contain some dead and decaying matter, some organic matter, some inorganic matter. So all these forms of impurities may be found in the water. Okay, so it may be a groundwater or surface water. Relatively, groundwater is less polluted compared to the surface water. So unless it is having some industrial leachate and other pollution, the surface water is more susceptible to the pollution. So basically, based on those impurities, it is classified into three main types, that is physical impurities, chemical impurities and biological impurities. Okay. So the potable water should be colorless, odorless, it should have good taste, and it should not contain any harmful microbes. So that we call it as potable water, that is water free from all forms of impurities. So water, since we will close this session, water is a very precious resource for mankind, and we should cherish and we should protect all forms of water resources, because without water there is no life. And in this session we have seen that what is the various percentage of water which is available, what is meant by surface water, what is meant by groundwater, how the water is polluted, and what are the sources of water, it is rivers, lakes and streams, then what is the different forms of impurities. So in detail we will study about these water quality parameters, that is physical, chemical and biological parameters, because once if you know what is the parameters, then you can properly decide the alternative treatment methodologies, so that which we can propose for supplying the safe drinking water to the communities. Okay, so let us stop this session and we shall continue in the next class.